On October 7th, 1949, at 5:30 p.m., 26-year-old Jean Spangler leaves the apartment on Colgate Avenue, saying that she was going to meet her ex-husband to talk about child support payments. Then after that, she's going to go work at the studios. No one ever saw her again.
That's interesting that you decided to start yours the same way of, like, the mystery. The mystery. And now let's unsolve it.
Yeah, no, unsolve let's it. Unpack this box here.
No, let's unsolve it.
So who is Jean Spangler? You didn't do research? Oh, this is, Daniel, you messed up big time this time.
This is Ellie Meekly episode final exam. You didn't study?
Why aren't you wearing pants?
Jean Spangler. You're in the wrong classroom.
You can't remember your locker combination?
Hello, the test ended an hour ago.
You're on stage at an open mic and you don't remember any of your jokes?
And you keep trying to riff and no one's laughing?
And no one's laughing and you pulling out notes but you can't read them?
Because you sweat all over them because you're so sweaty and everyone smells you?
I love nightmares. They're great.
Happy Halloween.
Our October episode should have just been nightmares
our
we
nightmare.
Have.
Nightmares we've had for the past 6 months.
Jean Spangler was born in Seattle on September 2nd, 1923. I'm not quite sure when her family gets to Los Angeles, but she graduates from Franklin High in Highland Park. By the time she was done with high school, she knew exactly what she wanted to do. She was already modeling and dancing in Florton Gardens and the Earl Carroll Theater. And by 1941, she was scoring some bit parts and extra work in movies and TV. She apparently appears in a movie called When My Baby Smiles at Me and another one called Chicken Every Sunday. Both horrible titles.
Chicken Every Sunday?
Chicken Every Sunday, which is, I imagine, going to be the title of your eulogy to your parents.
That's the motto of Dine LA.
Someone also shared a screenshot of her in a Three Stooges short, Mummy's Dummies.
Mm, that's spooky.
So she's like walking down a hallway in a swimsuit, if you are familiar with that.
If you're looking for racy pictures of women from the 20s.
Yeah, if you're looking for a screenshot to put on a post office or a milk carton to say this woman's missing, that's a good one to have.
Larry Moe, Curly.
And where a missing woman.
The fourth stooge.
Jean was a very beautiful woman, a tall, statuesque brunette with willowy hair in an era where it was very popular to be those things, so you could see her climbing the ranks and getting better roles one day. The next year, 1942, when she was 19 years old, she marries a plastic manufacturer named Dexter Banner, which is the name of an action hero. During the war, he was stationed with the Army in the South Pacific, but it wasn't a good marriage, and after 6 months, they filed for divorce, her accusing him of cruelty. He accused her of preferring parties to priorities, which is a perfect rhyme scheme. They later found out that during his time in South Pacific, Jean had had an affair with an Air Corps lieutenant.
Whoa, okay. I thought this was where the creepy part comes in. An Air Corps.
Air Corps.
An Air Bud.
Jean and Dexter also continued an on-again, off-again relationship that lasted about 5 years after they got a divorce, or I guess like through the divorce or something. And during this time when she was also with Dexter, she also had many other relationships with Min and Allie in Palm Springs, which if you're a beautiful unmarried woman now, do your thing, whatever. But during all this, in 1944, they had a child together, Christine. Their divorce wouldn't be finalized until 1946, so in the meantime, the two entered into a long custody battle over their daughter. Originally, custody was granted to Dexter, but after 2 years of battling over her, Jean was awarded custody of Christine. A week before her disappearance, she was seen in Palm Springs with a man named David Ogle, or as Mickey Cohen and his associates called him, Little Davey. She met him and several other mafia men while working at Florentine Gardens, which was a gangster hangout. I think it was on Hollywood Boulevard. 2 days before Jean disappears, Little Davey disappears after being indicted on conspiracy charges.
For some reason, I thought that Little Davey was her son. And I was like, oh no, he disappeared.
Oh no, he's in the
mafia? He was indicted. Start him young.
That does smell good.
Yeah, it does. This barbecue's really heating up. Excuse me, I gotta go tell them that across the river.
Excuse me, I left my mask on the other side of the river, but this party's really heating up.
Why does my throat hurt?
Your guys' throat hurt too? It didn't before I started talking, but now it does.
What is it, the 4th of July?
Okay, so let's get there. Jean lived in the Wilshire District, 6216 Colgate Avenue at the Palm La Brea Apartments, along with Christine, her daughter, her mom Florence, her brother Edward, and his wife Jean's sister-in-law Sophie. On October 7th, her mother's out of town. She has told her sister-in-law that she's going to the farmer's market to meet Dexter to talk about an increase in child support payments, which he is a week overdue with. After that, she's going to head to work as an extra for a nighttime shoot, so no one would see her till much later. That would be incredibly normal if no one saw her for the rest of the night. At 5:30, all dolled up and in good spirits, she said goodbye to her daughter and family and left.
These moments like that keep coming up in both of ours of like, and this, you know, this is the last time they ever spoke to anybody.
Yeah.
It's pretty sad.
It's very sad and creepy. Huh?
My left hand isn't up, so no.
And of course, the omen with wings are here.
Yeah, the crows are here. That's how you know the story's getting a little scary.
When the next day came and Jean wasn't home, Sophie filed a missing persons report, so please start investigating. Turns out Dexter says he did not meet up with Jean the previous evening, as she had told her sister-in-law. He hadn't seen her for a week. And police find out while investigating that no studio had plans for Spangler that evening. The Screen Extras Guild also look into it, and they have no record of a call for extra work that night, and neither do the TV studios. Police spoke with a co-star, Robert Cummings, who said in a casual casual conversation. He said that he was in a casual conversation with Spangler, and she mentioned being in a new romance. He asked her if it was serious, and she said, not exactly, but I'm having the time of my life. On top of that, a friend of Spangler's told investigators that Spangler informed her that she was pregnant before she had disappeared. Jean's friend, Shirley Ann Morris, told police that she saw Jean with an older man in a sedan on Lancashire Boulevard at 7:40 a.m.
An older man in a sedan?
Yeah.
Is that like a...
like a Beach Boy song?
Yeah. Old man in a sedan.
Old man in a sedan. You know the little old lady from Pasadena? This is her husband. You know what kind of house they have, what area they're in.
He's not home much. He's an old man in a sedan.
So her friend Shirley sees Jean with this older man in a sedan on Lancashire at 7:40 on the Thursday, the one before she disappeared. Like I was saying, I don't know if that's the night before she disappeared or the following week. They brought in Thomas Allery Evans, who was a gambler and ex-bodyguard of Tony the Hat Canero.
We were done with these gangster nicknames.
Okay, the Hat, for listeners who don't remember, is the gangster who had gambling ships. Off of...
Oh, that's the guy?
That's the Hat.
Oh,
off
wait,
the coast.
That's the one who might have killed JFK, right? Or wait, what was his name?
Tony Canero.
I think that's the one that there's a urban legend that he killed Kennedy.
That his hat has a grassy knoll underneath it.
Yeah, they call him the Hat because he's like odd job. And he,
yeah, that's right. Magic bullet or magic hat?
No one was looking for a hat, were they? Hats couldn't register on 16 millimeter.
Back then, you didn't even a background check to buy a hat. You could just get a hat off the
anywhere.
Rack. 9mm.
12-gallon, banana clips, whatever you needed on those things. You could get a little reporter's feather. Nobody asked questions.
Yeah, no one asked questions. No cops would stop you. It was the Wild West. That year, 1960. I don't remember when JFK was
1960 shot. Kennedy.
A year that we'll always remember. The early 60s.
A year that will live in infamy.
Yeah, a year that will live in infamy. The 40s.
The greatest generation. Old people.
Racist old people. So all the stuff about Canero, I don't know. I'll go back and repeat it a little. Bit. They brought in Thomas Allery Evans, who was a gambler and an ex-bodyguard of the Hat. They linked this guy with two missing persons. One of them was Spangler. The other one I'll talk about in a little bit. Mimi, you can't make fun of this name, okay? You can't do it. It's a missing person. You have to be really sensitive.
Fine.
Take a deep breath and I'm going to say it. Mimi Boomhauer. I didn't laugh at her name. I laughed at your face.
You're kidding me.
Mimi Boomhauer. And I can't laugh at it.
But Greg, it was on TV for like 12 seasons.
It's like Boomhauer married what's her name from...
Mimi Buffay.
Buffay, yeah.
Wait, no. That's Phoebe Buffay. Mimi from...
Drew Carey Show.
Drew Carey Show. What was her last name? Was her name also Buffay? Is she related to
Phoebe? I thought
it
was Buffay, but I don't...
Is she related to Phoebe from Friends?
Oh my God. She always talked about her twin sister. That's her twin sister.
Her twin sister looks nothing
that's
like
Ursula.
Her.
Mimi's Ursula. It surprised me how fast like Ursula. Pull that name out of my mental Rolodex.
There's certain things from Friends that have just stuck in our mind. Pivot.
Yeah,
we were on a break. Chandler Bong.
That's not even a real job.
Ursula is your Chandler Bong. Now okay, don't distract me from this woman's name being Boomhauer by bringing up the Drew Carey Show.
Hey.
I didn't know people's names could be Boomhauer. Does that mean Boomhauer's last name was Boomhauer, not his first name?
I have no idea.
Is he related to Phoebe?
Are all the blonde people on TV related?
I think they might be. I think we're onto something. The ultimate crossover.
three-camera live-action shows and an animated series that all take place in America, in the South and the East Coast.
The greatest country on earth, North America.
Where did Drew Carey take place?
Cleveland Rocks. So
Cleveland Rocks. That's what it was.
It took place in Cleveland Rocks, whatever state Cleveland is in. Oh, yeah, he yells it at the end of the song. Ohio.
I thought I was smart for knowing it right now. I'm being like, it's clearly Ohio.
Stick to Friends.
A clerk at a local market.
Right, I'll let it go.
A clerk at a local market told police that she saw Spangler on the night she disappeared October 7th. She came in the store alone, but said she looked like she was waiting for somebody. Hmm. Three employees at a cafe in Salinas, California, said they saw a woman matching her description eating there around lunchtime on Tuesday the 12th, so like a week after she disappeared.
And now, where's Salinas? Salinas
is up north by Monterey.
Okay.
It's Steinbeck country.
Yeah, it is. Whenever I've driven past Salinas, it's like, don't you want to see where John Steinbeck's from?
You don't want to walk his walk? You don't want to walk the beat? This is where he yelled at his dog. Travels with Charlie? That's where the Charlie happened.
These are the mice from Mice and Men. One of mine is a similar thing of like we saw them going like heading north shortly afterwards. I guess everyone just why would you take the PCH? If you're trying to escape, don't take the scenic route is what I'm getting at.
You got it. You're trying to argue with people who've disappeared under mysterious circumstances. Don't take PCH if you're trying to get away.
I'm trying to give advice how to disappear better.
The first real clue comes 2 days later, the following Sunday, when her black cloth purse is found at the entrance to Ferndale at Griffith Park. Have you been to Ferndale before?
No.
Okay, so there's Vermont that takes you up to the observatory, and I believe it's the back way out of there. It's where the Trails Cafe is. There's a little like cute little bridge park area that's enclosed.
So it's in Griffith Park.
You've heard of Los Angeles before, right? You've
Wait, been what's there? The Griffith Observatory?
So this the main entrance at the Griffith Park on the Hollywood side is up Vermont, basically. Right. And there's
like
another
going past
street.
The Greek?
Yeah.
I know that.
So if you go further by the bear statue where Clifford Clinton lived, when you're getting closer to Western, there's another street that goes up, I believe connects to the observatory on the opposite end. At the mouth of that is pretty much like, well, not at the mouth, but like 10 seconds out is Ferndale, which is like a closed, beautiful area to walk.
I mean, it sounds made up, but okay.
And this is Fern Gully, you're saying?
This is
with Christian Slater?
Is there some sort of crossover with Beavis and Butthead coming? Or like, why are you telling me this?
I hate this podcast so much.
Oh, go have fun with Glendale. Dun, dun.
Dun, dun.
There was a village. Not enough flute for my liking. Oh my God, the barbecue? What did he say?
Turn it off. I also heard trash can ho.
Sounds like the hamburgers are ready.
The straps of her purse were found to be ripped off. And inside, as the LA Times puts it, they find usual feminine trifles. Jesus Christ. And an unsigned, unfinished note.
Okay.
Addressed to Kirk, it read, "Can't wait any longer. Going to see Dr. Scott. It will work best this way while mother is away." The note ended with a comma as if it was interrupted while writing it.
We don't know any Kirk, do we? I'm not saying you and I, but in this story, do we know
not
Kirk?
So far.
Okay. Is this a Star Trek crossover?
It is actually a Star Trek crossover. When I was doing research, I thought Kirk, like Kirk Cameron, but in my head I saw Captain James Kirk Cameron. And my brain does that sometimes, and I think that I'm not well.
I think I'm having an aneurysm.
This is how strokes start. I smell toast. On the 15th.
That's the barbecue.
On the 15th, 60 members of the LAPD's Valley Division Reserve Squad rode horses through the 4,523 acres of Griffith Park looking for more clues. Starting from Ferndale, where the purse was found, then spreading outwards. They didn't find anything. So the two things.
Kind of hard to. I mean. That's a lot of ground.
Yeah.
Cover.
On horses, you're even farther from the ground. Were they blood easier? Horses? Like bloodhounds, but horses?
Yeah, really droopy, saggy horses.
So the two things cops have to go on is Dr. Scott and Kirk, who are mentioned in the note. Because of the claim from Jean's friend that she might have been pregnant, they suspected Dr. Scott might have been performing illegal abortions something went wrong.
That's what it sounded like to me.
Yeah. They searched L.A.
And I know abortions.
Trust me. They searched L.A. for any doctors with the last name Scott, but nothing turned up. Their most promising lean was a former medical student who frequented the Sunset Strip performing abortions for money. They confirmed his identity, but even with that, they were never able to locate him. No clues to his whereabouts, nothing. Oh, and the lieutenant that Jean had an affair with when she was married to Dexter, his name was Scotty. And this Scotty had been violent towards her and threatened to murder her if she broke off the relationship. But by all accounts, the two had been done for like 4 years and hadn't seen each other since. Then there was the Little Davy connection. She and Little Davy, the gangster.
Her gangster son.
Her gangster son boyfriend. No, so he leaves town for good. Maybe a lot of people are thinking, did she leave with Little Davy? Did she leave the country and leave her family behind? Or had she seen something that she wasn't supposed to and got whacked? In 1950, a U.S. customs agent in El Paso, Texas, told LAPD detectives that they might have spotted Jean Spangler at a hotel with Little Davy and Frank Nicoli, another LA gangster who had disappeared in September of 1949 because of similar charges that Davey faced. So these two guys that knew Spangler in the same year, around the same span of months, disappear, so they're thinking maybe she went with them. And then we have Kirk, the juiciest part for last. They never figured out who the note was addressed to. Jean's mother said that she had mentioned to Kirk, but Jean never stated who he was. But because he didn't want any special scandal on his name, Kirk Douglas called the LAPD from Palm Springs to tell them that Jean had been cast as
an
extra. Basically, that's the call. It was just like, because she was in a recent film of his, Young Man with a Horn, but he was like, I barely remembered her. We talked and kidded, he said, but never saw her before or after. Some people speculate that this was the man that she'd been seeing casually, nothing serious, but was having the time of her life. Was this casual fling
with Kirk Douglas?
And she got pregnant and he killed her.
Whoa.
Probably not, but juicy.
Yeah, that is juicy. I think we should blame the son. So you're saying Michael Douglas?
You're saying Ant-Man's Michael Douglas.
The ultimate crossover, Boomhauer meets Ant-Man. That's juicy. That's
juicy.
Some Hollywood juice right there.
I remember stumbling on that like on Tumblr like years ago and be like, oh, I wish I had a podcast to talk about this. And then I have one. I wish it was better.
Hang on, let me just put in some music drops a la Glendale Library. Kirk Douglas. I'll play the guitar solo from across the river.
We could just get all of the crow sounds. Every time I say something suspicious of the crow sounds.
That's when we're talking about Jet Li. No, wait, not Jet. Yeah, Jet Li.
No, not Jet Li. Brandon Lee. My favorite thing was that we're at an open mic. I think it was at Chris's house. But Ramsey was talking about like his idea of a sexy man, and it was the crow. And I laughed, but not because I thought it was funny, but because I agreed with him so much, and I had never thought.
I think you should revisit the crow.
No thanks. I like to like it. If I revisit it, yeah. I won't like it.
It's some things are best disappearing.
What's wrong with a movie about Devil's Night where all the bad guys who are in hackers are like, fire it up?
What's wrong with a movie if you wanted Batman to be the Joker, but he played guitar?
Played by Bruce Lee's son. It's all the things I like. Luella Parsons went on TV offering a reward for $1,000, which in the late 40s was over $10,000, for any information on Jean's whereabouts. Nothing substantial ever came in. No one knows what happened to Jean Spangler. She disappeared, with leaving behind only one cryptic clue and no leads to that.
Spartacus did this.
I killed her. Is Dexter lying about seeing his ex-wife about child support payments? Is Scotty lying about having not seen Jean for 4 years? Was an abortion gone wrong? A mob hit? A runaway mom? Is the Kirk in the note actor Kirk Douglas? We'll never know these things.
Mm-hmm.
To add even more to the Spangler case, a month before she went missing, 48-year-old socialite Mimi Boomhauer disappeared without a trace. She's like one of the women you hear about in mystery novels. She had inherited her lace...
Oh my God, these crows. You're getting too close to the heart of the issue here.
She was one of the women I hear about only in mystery novels. She had inherited her late husband's fortune and lived in their 10-room Spanish-style mission in the middle of Bel Air by herself, widowed for 6 years.
And she was very wary of the world and visitors.
And her neck was so perfect, like a perfect length for strangling, like a perfect circumference. As of that year, her money was on the skids and she was pawning stuff off. At 7 or 8 p.m. on August 18th of 1949, she spoke to a friend over the phone, then left her house in a change of clothes. She left her sedan locked and parked at home, and they found an uneaten salad on the dining room table and all the lights on.
Wait a minute, she had a sedan too?
Yeah. The sedan is not like a... It's not like a model of a car. It's like a type of car. Like, this is a sedan.
Yeah, I know, but I'm just... I think there's something going on with sedans here.
I think that if you owned a sedan in an era where sedans were being made only...
No, I'm a coupe kind of guy.
I drive an A-model jalopy. I'm not a sedan man.
I don't have any doors.
She left in a hurry or left expecting to return soon? Question mark. She didn't. Earlier in the week, she told a friend she would be busy on the night of the 18th and told her business manager she was going to meet a man that night, but didn't say who. And I don't mean to sound like my favorite murder, but always tell someone who you're meeting or who you're seeing. Don't be like, oh, it's my mystery man. I'll tell you tomorrow. Like, you're going to die.
I met him on the pre-internet.
I met him on the newspapers. Her gardener said that for a week prior to her vanishing, a middle-aged man with white hair would pull up an expensive-looking car in the driveway next door and watch her house. They never found out who that man was. Because she lived alone, she wasn't reported missing for several days. Some think she ran away and eloped because while discussing something, she slipped and said, let me check with my husband, but he'd been dead for 6 years. A full week later, on the 25th, they found a white calfskin handbag in a telephone booth on Wilshire Boulevard. On the side of the purse, someone had written this message: Police Department. We found this at the beach Thursday night. She went missing on that Thursday. Nothing unusual about the contents, not even any sand or water. She was declared dead 11 days after her disappearance, which is weird because usually it's 90 days, so then they reversed it. No one knows what happened to Mimi Boomhauer, not in the slightest, but many suspect murder.
You saying that they declared her dead so soon makes me think maybe it was a witness protection thing.
Oh, wow. I didn't think about that.